Hello my dear students, welcome to computer science class. Today in our video class, let us start with a flowchart to check whether a given number is prime or not. So what is prime number? Prime number is nothing but a number which is divisible by 1 and itself. Such numbers we usually refer it as prime number. Now before we start with the flowchart, let us understand how to find out the number is prime or not. See, suppose if I give the number as input as 14. Now, if I give the number as 14, it shouldn't have any integer divisors. That means what? The number 14 shouldn't be divisible by any other number except 1 and itself. Okay, but we know that already, that is 7 can divide it. 2 also can divide it completely. That means 2 7s are 14, it is completely divisible. 7 2s are 14, it is completely divisible. Then such a number is not a prime number. Then a number that is 5. Okay, number 5. So 5 is a number which is divisible by itself and divisible by 1. And apart from that, it doesn't have any other integer divisors. That means the number 5 is not completely divisible by any other number. Such numbers we usually refer it as a prime number. Okay, let us begin with our flowchart. So we know that this symbol is being used to indicate it is a start or the beginning, isn't it? Then next is we are asking the user to input the n value. That's why we have shown here as a parallelogram. Then next one is I've taken it as divided the given number to as n by 2. And that number, whatever I'm getting the n by 2, I'm storing it in a variable known as limit. What is the purpose of dividing this n value by 2 is, now suppose when I took the example, the given input as 14, if you carefully observe, its integer divisors lie between the range from, that is 2 to half of its given number, that means 2 to 7. For the number 14, the integer divisors lie between the range 2 to 7. Apart from 7, there is no other number which will divide the number 14 completely except the number itself. Now let us take another example. As given input to be as 8. If a given input as 8, then its integer divisors will lie between the 2 to its half of its number, that means 4. So 8 by 2 is 4. So its integer divisors lie between 2 to 4. So there is no any other number apart from more than 4 which will divide the number 8 completely except itself. Neither 5, 6, 7, these numbers cannot divide. So it is we need not to check the all the rest of the numbers. Only the half of its given number we can check. That is the reason why did I take here n by 2 and I have stored it in the variable known as limit. Now since it is an calculation part, I have taken it as a rectangle. Moving on to the next one, I am using the for loop. I know the loop has to iterate for a fixed number of time. That is why I have taken the for loop. So I am initializing I is equal to 2 but not I is equal to 1. Why? Because we know that every number can divide by 1. That is why I have starting my loop with the I is equal to 2 up to the limit. So when I is equal to 2, I'm checking whether the given number, when you perform the modulus operation, whether that remainder, if it is resulting in 0, then if it is true, so there's n mod I, if it is resulting in 0, if the condition is true, then it will print as it's not a prime number, else it will print as it's a prime number. Let me explain this one with the example here. Let us take the n value to be as 7. If the n value is 7, then obviously its integer divisors will lie with the half of its given number. So integer divisors, I'm referring it. Actually, half of its number, it will become 3.5. But since I'm referring to the integer divisor, the number will be 3 here. Okay, that is, 3. And how do I represent this for loop here? That is, we know that when it is n by 2 is 3, definitely the limit variables also contain the value 3. I is equal to 2, I should be less than or is equal to 3, because we know up to the limit it has to iterate. So I should be less than or is equal to 3 and I plus plus. Moving on to the next one here, I need to check the if condition here. If 7, n is what? 7. 7 mod I current value is 2. So 7 mod 2, is it resulting in 0? Whether 7 mod 2, is it in resulting in 0? Look at here. 2, 3 is a 6. What it is resulting? It is resulting in 1. So 7 mod 2, is it resulting in 0? The condition is false. See here. If this condition is false, you need to iterate back. Okay? You need to iterate back until this particular condition becomes false. So now once the incrementation takes place, I value will become 3. So 3 is less than or is equal to 3. Yes, your condition is true. If it is true, then check for the next condition. So here, if condition 7 mod 3, is it resulting in 0? No, we know that 3 2s are 6. Again, I'm getting the remainder as 1, which is not equal to 0. So again, the condition fails. If the condition fails, I gets incremented. Once I gets incremented, I becomes 4. 4 is less than 3. Yes, the condition 4 is less than 3. The condition is false here. Once the condition is false, it will stop iteration. In fact, the control goes to the next here, because we never satisfied the given condition. Therefore, the condition will never have the true part. So we have always the false condition. So the control goes to the false. So wherein we are using one connector here, through after that we are going to print the value, that we are going to print the output as it is a prime number. Therefore, 7 is a prime number because we didn't find any of its integer divisor until half of its given number. Therefore, 7 is a prime number. Now let us take another example when n is equal to 8. So when it's n is equal to 8, definitely I need to check its half of its range. So n by 2 is equal to 4. Therefore, limit is equal to 4. So initially, I is equal to 2. 2 is less than or is equal to 4. Yes, the condition is true. Then check. N mod I. That means 8 mod 2. Is it resulting in 0? Because we know that 2 4s are 8 and it is dividing it completely, where the remainder is resulting in 0. Since this condition is true, the true part of the statement will execute. So the control jumps to the true part and it will print that it's not a prime number. 8 is not a prime number because it is having its integer divisor as 2. So therefore, 8 is not a prime number. I hope this flowchart is clear to you. Moving on to the next topic, some important definition, that is the subtopic development of program or computer solution. So let us see the definition, what exactly the coding or the programming is. So the coding or programming is nothing but it is a process of translating the algorithm or the flowchart into the syntax of given programming language. That means we have always written the algorithm first, then the flowchart, then based on that we have written the program, isn't it? So what is actually the coding or programming is nothing but it is a process of converting either the algorithm into the programming or either the flowchart into the program with the syntax as well. This process of translating, we call it as the coding or the programming. Next, moving on to the next definition, what is the testing? Testing is nothing but it is the process of running or executing all the instructions which is written in the programming code by checking its logic by providing some sample input data in order to check its output. This process we call it as testing. Testing in a sense, suppose if you write a program called as an area to calculate the area of a circle, if you write a program. So it is a testing in the sense what? Process of executing all those instructions what you have written to calculate the area of circle, executing of all those instructions, and how do you are testing it by providing the sample input data in order to check its output. This process of testing, this process we actually call, we refer it as an testing. The next definition we should see to that, what is a debugging? Debugging is nothing but it is a process of finding and correcting the program mistakes, which are called as an errors. So this process we call it as debugging. So it is a process of finding and correcting the program mistakes called as an errors. Like you have done the practicals when you were performing, you people were debugging the program. So you were getting the list of the syntax and the semantic errors. Sometimes you were getting the runtime and the logical errors, isn't it? So you would get a list of errors. You would read those errors and try to understand and debug those errors. So what exactly you were trying to do? You were trying to find out the errors, and after finding, you were actually trying to correct those errors. So this process we actually refer it as debugging. I hope children you are able to understand what is coding, what is testing, and what is debugging. Now at the time of debugging, we are encountering different kinds of errors. So there are actually four different kinds of errors. So the first one is the syntax error, the next is semantic, the next one is the logical, and next one is the runtime errors. We shall discuss each of the errors in detail. Now, what exactly the syntax error? Syntax error is nothing but it is the set of rules which we need to follow at the time of writing the program. Such kinds of error, we actually refer it as an syntax error. So, I repeat, syntax error is nothing but the set of rules which we need to follow at the time of writing the program. At the time of writing those statements in the given program, we refer it as an syntax error, or you can even refer it as an some grammatical mistakes in the statements of the program. We can refer it as a syntax error. Let me explain this one with an example here. Look at this particular statement. So int a is equals to 5. Actually, we know that in C, in every programming language like C or C++ and all, every statement it has to terminate with a semicolon, but here the semicolon is missing. So the error which is being generated because of missing semicolon, such error we can refer it as an syntax error. Okay, then further one more example we shall see in this particular program segment, wherein we are actually multiplying the two given numbers. So the first error wherein you can encounter here, so this one, this statement produces the syntax error, okay, because the main function int and main are not the same words. This one is a data type followed by the main function. So this is one of the where we are getting the syntax error, followed by the, if you observe the third statement here, so this statement is missing the semicolon, so again a syntax error, then followed by this particular statement, fifth statement. So herein actually we need to provide a semicolon. Instead of that, we are having a colon. Again, this statement generates the syntax error. Again, followed by the last one. Again, here also we are missing a semicolon. So such errors, which actually we should follow the rules, and if we violate those rules, the errors will be generated. Those errors are referred to as an syntax errors. I hope you are able to understand. Moving on to the next error, that is semantic. What exactly the semantic means? Semantic actually refers to the logic. Okay, suppose if the wrong use of logic in the program, okay, any wrong usage of the logic, if we write it in the program code, the error generated because of that wrong logic, we refer actually it as an semantic errors. Okay, so semantic actually refers to the logic which we should actually follow at the time of writing the program. Suppose if we are making use of the wrong usage of the logic, if we are having, then the error which is being generated by that, we actually refer it as a semantic error. One of the example is usage of non-initialized variable. That means what? You are using the variable, okay, but without initializing it. Suppose example i++. Now look at this one. I haven't initialized actually what I should contain. I haven't initialized, but actually I'm asking the I value to get incremented. So what actually value the initially I should have, and what it has to get incremented, what value it has to attain after incrementation, that leads an ambiguity, isn't it? Such errors we actually refer it as an semantic error. Moving on to the next example here. Now look at this particular statement. So when you look at this, you will easily understand that whatever the values are there in z and x should be added and store it in the variable known as a. But actually this is not the way of writing or representing the assignment operator in the C++ programming language. The actual way of writing actually is z plus x, whatever the calculation happens to the right hand side should be assigned to the left hand side variable using an assignment operator. So this is the right logic what we need to follow at the time of writing the solution or at the time of writing the program. So errors, if we are generating, if we are violating the rules, if we are violating the logic how we have supposed to write, then such errors actually refer to as an semantic errors. Moving on to the next type of error, that is the logical error. What is this logical error? Actually, if the correct translation of an algorithm, if you have written the algorithm correctly, but at the time of conversion or at the time of, you know, translation from algorithm to the programming, and if it is producing the wrong results, okay, then such type of an error we actually refer it as a logical error. Now look at this particular example. What is the formula to calculate the area of circle? That is pi r square. Instead of writing the pi r square at the time of conversion or at the time of translation, if you write the, you know, given statement to be like, you know, pi into 2 into r. Now this one actually syntactically it is correct, semantically also it is correct, but actually we have actually written the wrong, you know, statement. Wrongly we have converted it, wrongly we have translated from an algorithm to the programming language. Then the errors, the because of this one we are getting the wrong output we are able to generate. So the errors caused by such kinds of, you know, situation, we actually refer it as an logical errors. I hope you are able to understand. Moving on to the last type of an error, that is runtime error. Now what is this runtime error? Runtime errors, these are the errors that are being detected during the execution of the program. Like for an example, a number which has been divided by zero. Such type of an error are usually referred to as a runtime, which normally, you know, which usually appear at the time of execution. And such errors we actually refer it as a runtime error. Now, so this completes the different types of, you know, programming errors. Moving on to the last topic here, the documentation and maintenance of, you know, development of programming. So what exactly this documentation and the maintenance is about? Documentation is nothing but it actually any reference material that would explain you how to use and maintain any of the program or the application. See, suppose for an example, if you buy any product, okay, so usually you will get one user's manual or usually you will get an user's guide you will get. So what exactly that manual, user's manual consists of? It consists of actually, you know, how to use and how to maintain that product. Now that particular, you know, reference material, we actually refer it as a documentation. Okay. So whether it is a program, whether it is a software, or whether it is an any application, or whether it is an any product, real-time product. So usually we have to have a documentation which will help you to maintain and use that particular program or the application. Now herein we have two types of documentation, that is the internal documentation and external documentation. What exactly this internal documentation? Internal documentation actually refer to as an technical documentation. Why we refer the internal documentation to be as technical documentation? Because it consists of, you know, various different kinds of variables what you are going to use in the program. Suppose for an example, if I have a program around 500 lines of code, in that 500 lines of code, if I have used around almost, you know, 10 different variables, if I have used, so this internal documentation consists of all those names of those 10 variables along with its data type. So whatever different kinds of variables you're going to use, that would be there in the internal documentation. Apart from that, this internal documentation also consists of, you know, the remarks or the comments. Usually whenever you write any program, we usually have a comment or the documentation section, and we know that you can add the comment at any point of a time. So what is these comments? Comment, isn't it? They are helping the programmers or the user to understand what each module is about. What is the, what this particular statement is written for. It is providing you some extra information about what exactly the program is about. What is the logic? What does that particular statement mean actually? So therefore, this internal documentation also consists of, certain remarks or the comments. So these remarks or the comments will help you to understand or to indicate the purpose of the module. Suppose if a simple arithmetic program, to perform an arithmetic operations, if you have written a program which consists of multiplication, subtraction, addition. So wherever you have written the logic of multiplication, you can add a comment. So that particular module will help you to and make the users understand that it is a logic to calculate the multiplication. So like that, the remarks and the comments would help you to indicate its purposes. And next, it will also allow the users to insert the spaces, blank lines, and help you to represent the program in a systematic manner. So because the internal documentation consists of all these things, it is also being referred to as a technical documentation. Now actually, who uses this internal documentation? Internal documentation has been extensively used by the programmer who will update the program code at the later stages. Okay, who will laterly after certain period of time, who will update that particular program or the application. The programmer actually makes use of this internal documentation. Moving on to the second type of documentation, that is external documentation. What is this external documentation? It is actually it consists of additional textual information about the application or the program. So what is this additional textual information? Suppose if we buy any product, as I said earlier, you are getting one user's manual. What exactly will be there in user's manual? It consists of all the instructions that how you to operate that particular product, isn't it? Now, isn't it that will become an extra additional textual information that is helping the users to understand how to use that product? Now that is what we call it as an external documentation. So who are actually using this external documentation? External documentation could be useful for the users. That means users means we, the one who uses that application or the program or the product. Or it would also help the developer, or it will also help the administrators. Okay, so actually in the external documentation, there are three types of documents. The one is the user's manual. What is this user's manual? User's manuals contains the all the instructions that would help you to operate by for that particular users who are actually using those applications or the program. Suppose if I write any program, okay, on arithmetic operations, if I write a program and if I hand over to the user may not understand how did I write the programs and everything. But if I give an extra additional textual information to him, how to give the input, how you are able to expect it to get the output of it. So he will go through that manual, whatever the extra textual information event. Then he will understand how to operate, how to make use of that particular program. Then such kinds of manual which is helping the user to operate on that program or the application, we call it as an user's manual. Then the second type of document, we call it as an administrator manual. What is this administrator manual? It consists of actually the instruction for the users who are going to manage that particular program or the application. Because see, the one who manages that application or the one who manages that particular program, what has been written, they also need certain extra information. They also need certain textual information that how to manage it, how to periodically review it. They need certain instructions. So such document which consists of those instructions, so that is helping the users who are actually going to manage that application, we call it as an administrator's manual. And lastly, developer's manual. Developers contain, their manuals contain actually all the low level flowchart it contains. All it will contain the data dictionaries. Data dictionary in the sense, a huge collection of data which is there in that particular application or the program. okay, and then it also involves the decision tables, files, you know, complete system chart it will be holding, so that the developer may update the that particular application or the program. The such information which will be useful to update the application or the program, we refer it as a developer's manual. So this is what all about the external documentation. And the last topic is the maintenance. See, once we write any program code or once we develop any application, we need to update it periodically because it becomes an outdated at the time. Suppose you have a different kinds of applications we have, and when you have those applications in your mobile, isn't it after every certain number of days it will give one pop-up message in your mobile phone that you need to update it, isn't it? So because as time goes on, your programs or the application becomes outdated with the time, so you need to maintain your program. And the maintenance in the sense, like sometimes it so happens they may be error prone, or sometimes the user's requirement may change. So as per the user's requirement change, you need to update and you need to modify your program. What is the way to update or modify your program is you need to have a periodic review of the programs. Periodic review in the sense you need to after few times, suppose if you generate any one application, okay, for this month you have generated, after certain 2 months again you need to review it. Is there any new requirements from the users? If new requirements are there, you need to modify. If users' requirements are not there, if your application is working well and fine, give some sample data and check its output, whether it's quietly working normally or not, whether it's generating correct output or not. Like this, you need to keep on periodic review of your program or the application. So this is how you need to maintain. So maintenance is a continuous task, okay? So therefore you need to maintain your programs, okay, as per the user's requirements. I hope students you are able to understand. So in today's video class we have completed the flowcharts. We have almost different flowcharts we have completed in the previous video class. Now we have completed with to find out the given prime number. Is a given number is a prime or not, and then we have seen the different definitions of coding, programming, isn't it, coding or the programming, testing, debugging. Then we have seen the different types of errors. Then we have seen the how to document and how to maintain the program or the applications. So in our next video classes we shall start with the programming construct. Students, I hope you are able to understand. Stay home, stay at home, and take care of yourself, students. Thank you.